Last month, the UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres explained that while children were thankfully being spared from the most severe symptoms of COVID-19, their lives are still being totally upended. He warned that children around the world are facing grave risks in their education, food, health, as well as safety. On this Children's Day edition of Korea 24, we wanted to shed light on the vulnerability of children during this pandemic, especially to domestic violence and abuse. For that, we have now on the line Ms. Alessandra Guedes, Manager of Gender and Development Research at the UNICEF Office of Research Innocenti. Thank you for speaking to us today.
Thank you.
Now, as I mentioned, the UN Secretary General highlighted the need to protect children during this pandemic in a very impassioned video statement last month. What kinds of risks do children face currently?
Yes, it's really interesting because on the one hand, as you mentioned, children are being spared from the worst symptoms of the pandemic itself, of COVID itself. At the same time, the measures that are being taken to prevent and contain the pandemic are placing children at risk. We are seeing an increased number of calls to hotlines that provide support to children who are experiencing abuse. We are concerned about children who may not be able to access the help that they need because places such as schools that usually serve as a frontline mechanism to identify children who need help are closed in so many parts of the world. Mm. So we are quite concerned about children's risks of exposure to different forms of violence in the home.
Right. So while things like lockdowns have helped to given the opportunity for some families to spend more time together, it's become a nightmare for others. Today, we especially want to highlight abuse and violence against children. Is there evidence that abuse has increased during this pandemic? Have countries reported more cases?
What we're seeing in the media are a number of reports of increased calls to hotlines and to help-seeking services. It's going to take us a while to determine whether that's actually representative of an increase in the prevalence of the levels of violence or whether that's just an increase in help-seeking behavior. Having said that, we know that the measures that are absolutely necessary to contain COVID can exacerbate a number of risk factors that are associated with violence. As you mentioned, parental stress in the household because of the economic hardship, because parents are having to educate their children and maintain their job and earnings, increasing care responsibilities, particularly amongst girls and women. And all of those factors can exacerbate the risk that children experience violence in the home.
Right, so you're saying it's simply because abusive parents and family members are spending more time at home that this is happening?
Well, it's both because children may be in situations where abuse was already taking place, but also because parents may be, and other caregivers may be under exacerbated stress. Right? Mm. We are all facing economic hardship and uncertainty, and some people may resort to unhealthy behaviors such as drinking, which we know increases the risk of violence as well. So you have children who may already have been living in situations of violence in the home, and you have other situations where these stressors may lead parents to use violence. Right. Both against children, and in some cases also we are seeing cases of violence against women in the home as well.
Right, so I guess it's a sort of perfect storm of stress and situation that is exacerbating the situation. Okay, so what can be done to help these children? How can governments and authorities act to protect children against domestic violence?
So I think the first thing is doing things like what we're doing now in this interview, raising awareness that even though children are the invisible carriers of COVID, they're exposed to a number of other risks that we may not immediately consider, right, including the risk of violence. We must ensure that all services to prevent and respond to violence in the household against both children and women are deemed to be essential in COVID-19 response plans. So we must ensure, governments must ensure that there is funding to keep these services going. We must do everything that we can to prevent such violence from taking place, right? And this includes measures such as paid sick leave for caregivers, child care support, minimizing child-family separation. And we also must do everything that we can so that children who've experienced violence can access care after the violence has occurred. This includes increasing access to hotlines, making sure that those hotlines are continuously in service, that they're not interrupted due to COVID, provision of psychosocial support to children who've experienced violence, training frontline health workers, frontline workers, including health, social workers, so that they are able to identify children who've experienced violence, providing special assistance to those groups that we may already know that are at high risk of violence because of economic hardship or because of disability status. So we must act both to prevent and to respond to violence once it has occurred.
You've just listed various ways that we can do to help children in this way. Have countries been acting to deal with a situation like that? Have you seen evidence of that?
Yes, we have seen countries take all of these measures to different extents. I think that it's safe to say that COVID caught most countries by surprise because of its sheer size. So there's an uneven level of response to all things COVID, including violence. But UNICEF is doing all it can to produce guidelines to support countries in their efforts. We're also undertaking research to assess to what extent COVID has increased the levels of violence, of different forms of violence in the home. So we are supporting countries in their efforts to respond to COVID.
It must be very challenging to root out these causes of violence and these instances of violence as well. I understand it's hard enough to find and prevent in normal circumstances anyway.
Yeah, you are absolutely right. And I think that that's a very good point. You know, I think we've seen sometimes in the media this headline that violence has been caused by the lockdown or violence is caused by COVID. But those of us who have been working in this field for a long time know that that's not the case. What this pandemic has done is it has exposed and magnified the inequalities that many children and women around the world experience and the violence that they experience in the home. We already know that for many women and children, home is simply not a safe place to be. We know from really solid data that over 50% of children experience violence either in the home or in the school settings. We know that one in three women experience physical or sexual violence by an intimate partner globally. So on the one hand, you know, being at home because of these measures to contain COVID has unveiled, if you will, this violence that many children experience around the world. So I think what we need to do is use this opportunity to shed a light on this unacceptable levels of violence and use this opportunity to strengthen measures, not just during COVID, but I think it's really important for us to ensure that these measures are sustained after the height of COVID has passed. Because although some children will experience higher levels of violence because of these measures, although some children may be experiencing violence for the first time because of the stressors, it's clear to us that under normal circumstances, quote unquote, too many children and women experience violence in the one place that's supposed to be the safest, in their home.
What final advice do you have for governments and policymakers to ensure that children are safe from domestic violence?
Governments should do everything that they can, funding, strengthening capacity of key health workers and other health providers and social workers, recognize that this situation and the measures that are being put in place to contain COVID may have an inadvertent effect in terms of increasing children's exposure to violence. Make sure that violence prevention, violence against children and violence against women prevention and response are considered essential components of any efforts to respond to COVID. Support parents by implementing measures such as paid sick leave, child care support, child feeding programs, parenting programs. Find creative ways to share information with parents about how they can relieve stress, how they can discipline children in a nonviolent way to prevent violence in the first place, and put in place also measures to ensure that if violence happens, children have access to the care that they need, psychosocial support, legal support. And again, I can't emphasize this enough, violence-related interventions and measures should be a key component of any effort to address COVID-19 now in the height of the epidemic, in the pandemic, but also going on to the future.
It's just heartbreaking to think about this situation. Is there anything everyday citizens like myself can do or should be doing to help the situation as well?
Absolutely. If you know of a family that's experiencing hardship, offer support. And support can be in as simple a way as providing food and essential needs. Offer to talk to the person if you have a relationship that's close enough to someone who you think is being violent. Approach that person and try to talk to them. If you know someone who may be experiencing violence, let them know that violence is never the fault of the person who experiences. Try to identify services in the area that you can connect them to and offer your unconditional and non-judgmental support. Mm. I think that's the most important thing for anyone who experiences violence, to know that, that violence is not their fault and that you're there to support them unconditionally.
Well, normally on Children's Day here in Korea, it's usually a chance to celebrate the future generation. But today we looked at how we can also better protect them. Thank you, Ms. Guedes, for helping better understand how we can do that. And we hope all children can stay safe during this pandemic and beyond. We've been speaking to Ms. Alessandra Guedes from the UNICEF Office of Research in Ascenti. Thank you for your time today.
Thank you very much, and thank you for shedding a light on this. And I will, if I may, do a shout-out to BTS, the wonderful Korean pop band that has been such a key partner to UNICEF in the Love Myself campaign, helping us to spread the message that violence is preventable, that violence is not acceptable, and that together we can prevent violence against children and against women. Thank you so much.
No, thank you, Ms. Guedes.